Thanks to everyone for coming out this morning. My name is Eli Ratner. I'm the Deputy Director of the Asia Program at CNAS. We have such an enormous amount of talent here at the table and looking out on the audience here, and a number of people who can speak on these issues that I want to get right into it here. As Bob mentioned, the first panel this morning is going to talk about the threats in the first island chain, and then the second panel, which Dr. Cronin will moderate, will look towards some of the future responses. I think you have the bios available to you, so let me keep introductions very short. To my right, Professor Bud Cole from the U.S. National War College, Dr. Michishita from GRIPS, the National Graduate Institute of Policy Studies. To my left, Dr. Lowe from Seoul National University, Vice Admiral Koda from the Japan Maritime Self-Defense Force, and Brian McGrath from the Ferry Bridge Group. Speaking order will be in that order. The first three will have about 10 minutes, and then for responses, 5 to 7, and then we'll open it up for questions. So I think feel free to speak from your seat if you'd like. So, Bud, go ahead.
Well, I'd like to thank CNAS for the honor of inviting me to speak here this morning. And as a government employee, I have to give a disclaimer that my views of my own don't represent those of the National War College or any other agency in the U.S. government.
Right.
The topic, the future threat, kind of put me back a bit, because from one perspective, the threat is already here. Speaking earlier this week, Admiral Locklear, the Pacific Commander, cautioned that the United States was no longer going to be able to maintain complete control over the Pacific Ocean. And I think it was at the same conference that Admiral Courtney, Forces Commander in Norfolk, said that we really were trying hard to settle on an 8-month standard deployment for aircraft carriers. Now, 20 years ago, the standard was 6 months. Those of us who can remember back to Vietnam remember 10-month and longer carrier deployments. And in fact, that's what some of them have been doing in the last decade. Very difficult to maintain, obviously, in terms of personnel and material resource, not just in the immediate sense, but also over the life of a particular ship or aircraft. So these are indications that the U.S. Navy is certainly beginning to feel some constraints in exercising future deployments and commitments. The Chinese Navy, on the other hand, continues to expand. And let me talk about what I think is a primary area of concern. And I freely admit that I kind of stole this idea from former Ambassador Stape Roy. And that has to do with what China calls the three seas: the Yellow Seas, the East China Sea, and the South China Sea, or sometimes the Near Seas. This is an area I think is becoming increasingly apparent Beijing considers to be vital to its national security concerns. You might call them the Toro waters. There are direct concerns in the United States, of course, because of our security treaties with the Republic of South Korea, with Japan, with the Philippines, with Australia, the special relationships, a term I like to use for our relationships with Taiwan, Singapore. We even have a logistics agreement with Malaysia and a near treaty with Thailand. So all this means that both the U.S. and China have vital interests in these three seas area. With two specific areas, of course, in the East China Sea, where we see China challenging Japan both over seabed resources and over the sovereignty of the Senkakus, or the Diaoyudais, as the Chinese refer to them. In the South China Sea, obviously, we have the unanswered question, certainly unanswered to an extent, about whether China is claiming just the land features within the well-known 9-dash line, or whether they're claiming all of the water areas as well. And even that doesn't really describe the potential for that claim, since if one reads the declarations China made when it signed the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, they caveated not claiming sovereignty over at least as far as 200 nautical miles from a recognized island, that is the exclusive economic zone. And there's even a phrase in there indicating that they might claim sovereign territorial rights out to the limits of the continental shelf, which itself is a debatable land feature or ocean feature. In fact, a couple of years ago, I once broke out a chart of the South China Sea and drew 200 nautical mile circles around all of the land features in the South China Sea that China claimed. Not just recognized islands, but rocks and reefs and so forth. And it covers a remarkably large percentage of the South China Sea. We have seen this very recently, brought even more to our attention with the so-called Hainan fishing regulations that have been issued. The issue here is not so much the fishing regulations, which we can date back to the late 1990s, and which were originally intended to try to control Chinese fishermen in the South China Sea, not very successfully, I might add. I think Chinese fishermen, like fishermen around the world, are about the most independently minded people there are. But rather how they define the area in which they are going to try to enforce these fishing regulations, and that has not been made clear by Beijing. In fact, it's not even clear that these regulations came directly from Beijing, as I suspect they did, frankly, or whether they were indeed a provincial innovation. In terms of Chinese naval modernization, let me just touch briefly on that. Obviously, they've built a tremendous number of conventionally powered submarines, over 30 in the last 12 or 13 years. They now have an aircraft carrier, which just completed its first group exercise in the South China Sea. The Liaoning is much more of a political statement right now than it is a viable naval weapons platform. But I'm fairly confident that within the next decade, we'll see China build two or three indigenous aircraft carriers, quite possibly nuclear powered. This indicates the recognition of the need for air power at sea, at least throughout the southern extremities of the South China Sea. I think an SU-27 taking off from Hainan has a very limited on-station time in the southern reaches of that sea. The aircraft carrier will obviate this restriction. They are building some new surface combatants, but I think at a relatively moderate rate. Perhaps the most significant ship they've launched, I think, or ships in the last decade, though, have been a hospital ship and a large amphibs, what we would call a landing platform dock. Because these two classes of ships allow China really for the first time to participate in what we like to call missions other than war, that is, humanitarian assistance from a sea-based platform. They were not able to do this as a result of the 2004-2005 disasters in the South China Sea and Indian Ocean. They have been reluctant for political reasons to render very much assistance to the Philippines, although they finally did dispatch the hospital ship, which they call the Peace Ark, to the PI. But nonetheless, they now at least have the naval means to participate in these humanitarian relief missions. Whether or not the political will is there to do that remains an open question. I think China does not have a written maritime strategy. In fact, most of the maritime strategies written by nations around the Pacific and throughout Asia are as much political domestic statements, I think, as they are really meaningful strategic documents. But China certainly, I think, in my view, at least has demonstrated a de facto maritime strategy, if you will. And I think that is to, they want to be able to control the seas out to the first island chain by 2020. And that's a line drawn roughly through the Kurils, Japan, the Ryukyus, Taiwan, Philippines, and around to the west through Indonesia. And that they want to control the seas out to the second island chain by 2049 or 2050. That's a line from the Kurils through Japan, the Bonin Islands, Marianas, Palau, and then again west through Indonesia. Now, when I say control of the seas, I do not mean sort of a Mahanian, Alfred Thayer Mahan definition of command of the seas. But what I mean by control of the seas in Beijing's case is that China does not want events happening in those maritime areas of which it does not approve. In the near term, that means Taiwan, obviously. In the midterm, it includes the East China Sea and the South China Sea. In the long term, my ideas are about as good as yours. The question from a U.S. perspective is, what's the threshold? What we see in the South China Sea today is probably best described as salami slicing tactics. It's easy for China to muster its forces against the Philippines or perhaps even against Vietnam. Although once Vietnam has its 6-kilo submarines operable, that may be a different case. It's also interesting, I note, that the Indian Navy is training the first kilo crew for the Vietnamese. That must bother the hell out of Beijing. But at what point do these salami slicing tactics in the South China Sea, be it against the Mischief Reef or Scarborough Shoals or Sand Island or whatever, At what point is that going to evoke a U.S. response? Because absent a U.S. response, I see no I see Beijing not hesitating to continue these salami slicing tactics, reaching for its ultimate goal of, in fact, having at least de facto control and perhaps de jure sovereignty over the entire South China Sea, at least over all the land features. There was a rather alarmist article in the middle of the Times earlier this week saying that China was planning an amphibious assault against, I forget the name of the island that the Philippines had built an airstrip on. That, I suspect, would cross the threshold. But I don't know what the U.S. threshold is. I'm not sure anybody in this town does. But I think defining that threshold in some sort of terms that Beijing would understand would lend some coherence to what we see going on in both the East and South China Seas today. Thank you.
Right. Good morning, everybody. My name is Narushige Michishita. I teach at the National Graduate Institute for Policy Studies based in Tokyo. Thank you very much for coming early in the morning today. And I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this important session. I'm particularly glad to be here because Bob Walk and I were classmates at SAIS when I was studying there between 1992 and 94. We went to 29 pubs together and things like that. Patrick Cronin was my teacher. He taught us alliance politics at SAIS. So I'm glad and honored to be here with old friends as well as new friends. Today, I'm going to make a comparison, talk about certainly military strategies or in Asia right now. But in order to do so, I draw a comparison between military strategies in Asia during the Cold War and at the present time. It's very hard to understand where we are right now if we don't have a benchmark to compare. And in order to I will give you a brief kind of description of what we had strategies that the Soviet Union, the United States, and Japan adopted during the Cold War, particularly toward the end of the Cold War in the 1980s, and provided it as a benchmark. And then in the second part, I'll draw some similarities, talk about similarities and the differences between the strategies during the Cold War and at the present time, so that we can see better understand the characteristics of the strategic environment in Asia right now. Okay, let me first talk about the strategies during the Cold War. And what the Soviet Union did during the Cold War, or it was doing during the Cold War, if you take a look at the map, the Soviet Union deployed nuclear-powered submarines with strategic ballistic missiles, or which is called SSBNs. Great. Here, in the Sea of Ohotsk. And by the way, these missiles loaded on these SSBNs were aimed at the United States. Then Sea of Ohotsk into a bastion, strategic bastion for its SSBNs, or nuclear-powered submarines equipped with ballistic missiles, long-range ballistic missiles. Then, in order to protect these important strategic assets, Soviet Union deployed attack submarines, surface combatants, and Tupolev F-22M backfire bombers in this area. That was a background for the rapid Soviet buildup during this period in the 1980s. Then the United States, the United States assessed that in order to protect these important assets in the Sea of Ohotsk, the Soviet Union decided to draw two defense lines in this area. One was called the sea control line here. This is Kamchatka Peninsula, and this is Sakhalin, and these are Japanese islands. And the first island, sea control line was drawn here, and sea denial line was drawn out there in the Western Pacific. And the distance between the Soviet East Coast and the sea denial line was about 2,000 kilometers. How did the United States respond to this? The U.S. adopted an offensive strategy called the maritime strategy, and the idea was, well, this is, maybe you can't see it. Let me stick to this map. The idea was that was to use aircraft carrier battle groups and nuclear-powered submarine attack submarines, SSNs, to threaten and or destroy, in case of war, Soviet SSBNs deployed in the Sea of Ochotsk. So you can see U.S. Carrier battle groups here. And it was supposed to penetrate these defensive lines into the Sea of Ochotsk and conduct offensive operations against Soviet, very important Soviet nuclear strategic assets. Then there was a Japanese military role, the roles that, important roles that Japan played during this period. In this strategic setting, the United States requested Japan to help the U.S. in the maritime strategy, for the execution of the maritime strategy. And Japan, after some, you know, kind of it was at first reluctant, but eventually said yes, and undertook two important military missions. There are two important military missions. One was a blockading of three choke point straits, particularly Soya Strait between Sakhalin Island and Hokkaido, and the Tsugaru Strait between Hokkaido and the Honshu, the main island, and the Tsushima Straits between Korean Peninsula and Japan. And the aim was to destroy about 30% of Soviet forces at these choke points, the Soviet forces which would try to come out to the Western Pacific to kind of maintain these defense lines. And toward the end of the Cold War, this 30% objectives were more or less achieved. Then another role that Japan decided to undertake was defense of sea lanes, because at best, even if we did a good job of destroying Soviet forces at these choke points, you know, I said 30% at best, in the best case scenario. That means another 70% of Soviet forces would come out to the Western Pacific to engage in, you know, defensive warfare against the U.S. Kind of invading U.S. attack strike forces. And Japan decided to play the role or provide defense of sea lanes in order to protect particularly U.S. carrier battle groups, which was would approach the Sea of Ochotsk in order to conduct offensive operations against the Soviet air and naval assets in this area and ground assets in order to protect the bastion in the Sea of Ochotsk. Okay, what are the similarities and differences between then and now? There, I would point out four basic similarities. One is, as we talked about, Soviet Union decided to draw two defensive lines out in the Western Pacific, sea control line and the sea denial line. Now China is drawing two similar defense lines. One is called First Island Chain, and the second called the Second Island Chain. And the sea denial line that the Soviet Union used to maintain was about, as I said, 2,000 kilometers or 1,000 nautical miles, whereas this second island chain is about, at the longest distance, point of longest distance, it's about 2,700 kilometers. So it's a little bit different, but more or less the same kind of defensive lines. A second similarity is the fact that whereas Soviet Union tried to turn a Sea of Ochotsk into a sanctuary or bastion, China is trying to turn the Sea of South China Sea into a sanctuary. China, Chinese leaders, some of them has called a or characterized the South China Sea as a core interest or a part of its core interest, and the Chinese authorities are now saying, don't fish here in South China Sea without our permission. And another interesting similarity is that the Soviet Union maintained the SSBNs in this area, but now China is constructing a base, naval base, for their SSBNs in the Hainan Island in the Sea of South China Sea. A third similarity is the assets that they are trying to maintain or construct. The Soviet Union maintained SSBNs, SSGNs, attack submarines with missiles, DDZs, destroyers with guided missiles, and aircraft carriers, and long-range bombers such as Backfire, in order to kind of maintain anti-access area denial capabilities. China is doing the same. They have procured SSNs, attack submarines, and destroyers, Sovremenny class destroyers, with a lot of large number of anti-ship missiles, aircraft carriers. They are constructing their own version of SSBNs, and they are procuring J-20, which might have more or less the same missions as Backfire bombers. And plus, this is a kind of new element, but there China is supposed to be developing anti-ship ballistic missiles. Finally, our strategies seems to have a lot in common. We used to have maritime strategy, which was with a capitalized M and a capitalized S. This is a kind of term that the US Navy was using. But now we are talking about air-sea battle, which have, you know, many similarities with maritime strategy. What about differences? First difference is that during the Cold War, as I said, there are only three strategic choke points in the vicinity of the Sea of Ohotsk: Sohya, Tsugaru, and Tsushima. But there are a larger number of routes that the Chinese vessels can use in order to go into the Western Pacific. Supposedly, there are at least nine. China says there are nine, but we think there are a little bit more than that, like 12. A second difference is that Kuril Islands, which the Soviet Union was using as a barrier to the defending the Sea of Ohotsk, belong to the Soviet Union. Certainly, northern territories are Japanese territories, but they are occupied by the Soviets. So they could use those island chain. But now, good news is that we call it Southwestern Islands, but the Ryukyu Island chain, these Japan administer or possess and administers these islands. So we can use it as a barrier in a current strategic environment. That's a good news. And the good news, it was good that it was kind of bad that the Soviet administered northern territories, whereas we administer the Senkaku Islands. But the good news is that we have the islands, but bad news is that we have to defend these islands. So there are kind of more obligations, difficult obligations that we have. Third difference is the kind of capabilities of the Soviet Navy and the Air Force and Chinese counterpart. Soviet Navy and Air Force were very highly capable, particularly toward the end of the Cold War. Soviet Union conducted two major naval maneuvering exercises. In 1970 and 1975, the naval exercises called the Okean 1970 and the Okean 1975. Certainly, Chinese naval activities are kind of becoming much more and more proactive, and these are invisible. But there have been so many different kinds of maneuvering operations that the Chinese, or exercise training and exercises that the Chinese Navy has been conducting in recent years. But if you compare the level of sophistication and the size, it's simply incomparable to those that the Soviet Union were conducting in the 1970s. So Chinese Navy is coming up, but it's not there yet. Fourth difference is that when the Soviet Union arrived in Asia in the 1970s during the Cold War, you know, we kind of knew how to play the game. Because, you know, the U.S. and Soviet Union experienced different types of crisis, you know, Berlin crisis, Cuban Missile Crisis, 1973 Middle Eastern crisis. So they knew, and that there was a kind of, agreement in order to, in terms of naval safety. But China is not as experienced as the Soviets were right now. And it's the Chinese Navy is back on the stage after 100 years of absence. So they don't know how to play the game. We don't know how to play the game. So as a result, EP3 incident took place in 2001. Chinese has been, taking pretty aggressive moves in recent days and, months. Chinese naval vessels had fire control radar locked onto the Japanese destroyers and established air defense identification zone unilaterally and things like that. So we don't know how to play the game, and the crisis will, I think, more crisis is forthcoming. Finally, this is a kind of bad news. During the Cold War, Europe and Asia were strategically coupled. Because the Soviet Union was a global superpower, if we did a good job in bolstering our defense capabilities in Asia, Europeans were happy. But now, China is a regional power. It's a great power, but regional power. So Europe, the strategic interest of European countries and Asian countries have been kind of different, which have been decoupled. So that's a bad news. So European friends are not as committed as they are to the defense vis-a-vis China. So what we have been doing is to make friends with partners in Asia and not necessarily partners in Europe. So we focus on Asian kind of partners, and we have named names in the Japanese case. We have named names of potential partners in our recently published national security strategy, as well as the National Defense Program guidelines. And those countries include South Korea, in the order that we describe these names, South Korea, Australia, Southeast Asian countries, and India. So that's where we are right now. And we hope, and finally, I'm sorry, I missed one last thing, which is a difference that this is a kind of bad news. Soviet Union had a command economy, and its economic performance very low. But Chinese one is, communist managed, but still market economy and much more robust. So during the Cold War, the Reagan military buildup broke the Soviet Union, but China might be able to break us in 1-on-1 arms race. So the countries in Asia must stick together. Thank you very much.
Okay, great, thank you. I think for a slightly different perspective, we're going to hear perhaps a Korean perspective from Dr. Lo. He's going to remain in the chair.
Thank you, Eli. I don't know how different this is going to be, but I should probably begin by saying that I'm what you call a target of opportunity for Pat Cronin. I was here yesterday for another talk, and just before I came, Pat invited me to come and speak at this meeting. Had I known it'd be this kind of an audience, I would have brought first and foremost a very large map of the Western Pacific, or perhaps the whole Pacific region, and sort of put, we haven't used the word threat, the Chinese maritime or naval threat in perspective. Where do you suppose, even if in the very near future, the Chinese People's Liberation Army Navy built a carrier task force, let's say tactically it wanted to go 4,000 kilometers from, let's say, Shanghai out into the Pacific, what would it do out in the middle of the ocean? Where would it go to be refueled? Who would resupply them? Where would the crew go to rest for a couple of days? The first island chains? Ladies and gentlemen, the Chinese at the present moment don't have any ports outside of the Chinese mainland where the Chinese naval forces could dock, rest, refuel, resupply, do whatever they need, repair. That kind of puts you into the kind of mental place that I'm coming from. Of the three allies, the US, Japan, and Korea, we probably have the smallest navy, but I don't think we feel as threatened by the Chinese naval forces as yet, because we do realize the limitations on their capabilities. They do have a refurbished old Soviet-era carrier, which in the Soviet days was called the Varyak, which at a point in its life, as a shell, was an amusement park for the Chinese people near Shenzhen. And for those of you who visited Shenzhen in this period in the 90s, you probably noticed Chinese pilots landing on a mock-up of a carrier deck on land and doing it very poorly for a very long time. And I'm not so sure how well the Chinese naval pilots would manage in rolling seas, in actual operational conditions, stuff that the American naval pilots do every day, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. Anyway, in photos they look good. I'm not so sure that they are as yet any real threat to the American 7th Fleet in the Pacific region. The US, on the other hand, ladies and gentlemen, has all kinds of friends in the region. In the southern extreme, beginning with Australia, all the way up to the Republic of Korea, including the Japanese islands, American naval combatants or peacetime operational ships can go anywhere, pretty much, in the Pacific region, now including Vietnam, to resupply, repair, replenish, rest, whatever it wants to do. The Chinese have friends in Pakistan, but I don't think it helps them grab control of the first island chains of the Pacific to have port access into Lahore in Pakistan. This is, however, not to belittle potential Chinese threats. But you know, threats are intents and capabilities. As I'm saying, the Chinese capabilities are extremely limited, even as yet. I don't think their intentions are to be hostile to US naval forces in the Pacific as yet, or in the near future. Please bear in mind, for a moment there, I was thinking about 1984 when we used to talk about the Soviet naval threat. This is during Mr. Reagan's second term, I think. my colleague, Dr. Mitsushita, was talking about the choke points, but what we call the EC in Koreans, the Sea of Japan in Japan. We had SOSUS, underwater sonar, stressed all across. And we would know when the Soviet submarines used to pass or Soviet ships used to pass 24/7. Back in those days. We still have it, we don't use it. But we would know if the Chinese ships moved in that region, but we don't use it anymore. The Soviets had no trade relationships back in those days with any East Asian country. The Chinese, on the other hand, depend critically on seaborne trade with the United States, with Japan, and with Korea. These three countries, the United States, Japan, and Korea, account for 90% of China's trade and investment, almost. Amazing, isn't it, to think about it? Why would the Chinese all of a sudden want to destroy all of the maritime relationships they have with these countries to the detriment of its economic well-being? Some future event may occur that might change all of these calculations in Beijing's eyes, but I don't see them at the moment. And I don't think I'll see them within my lifetime, at least. So yes, the Chinese are growing richer. Yes, they're investing more in their arms. Yes, they're building better ships somewhat. But the quality of their ships are not the quality of the ships that the US has or that Japan has or even we do. Their potential naval threat is there, but it's only a potential as yet. But more importantly, they don't have the alliance network that the US has built up over years and years and years. And Mr. Cole was talking about the first island chains. I was actually out at Subic Bay less than 3 weeks ago. Subic and Clark, former American bases in the region. And you know, there have been some investments into mediocre resorts in the Subic area because it's not used. But I mean, if the Americans declared an intent to the Philippine government at this moment, we'd love to come back to Clark and Subic and rebuild it back into a naval base, the Filipinos would, I think, would be the first to welcome you back. And the Chinese would have a very, very hard time with an enhanced US 7th Fleet or US Pacific Fleet, whatever you want to call it at some future point, presence in the Philippines. It would change, it would be a game changer. And these are beautiful port facilities. Clark was a strategic air base. And the Chinese would have nothing approaching this kind of capability in the region for the foreseeable future. Moreover, we have what's called the RIMPAC, a naval exercise run every year. And I don't think the Chinese would have any allies to conduct exercises with, like the US has with Australians, Koreans, Japanese, and other RIMPAC partners, to test its naval capabilities. On paper, it looks good. But as a real naval force that's been tested operationally and in combat, it's not anywhere close to what the US has in the region. So let's keep things in perspective. If any country ought to be worried about the Chinese, growing Chinese naval capabilities, it should be us, the smallest of the three military powers in this region. We're concerned, certainly. We have to put up with Chinese fishing vessels encroaching on our EEZ and their arrogance and all of that. But yes, these are irritants. But irritants are not military threats. Irritants are irritants. And we should keep things in perspective. And yes, 20 years down the line, 30 years down the line, if the character of Chinese domestic politics changes in a very detrimental fashion, and if the character of the Chinese state becomes detrimental to peace in the region, then yes, we should worry. But I think over time, the Chinese character of the Chinese political system will continue to change in a fashion that is progressive, shall we say, and in a direction that we would not want China to change. And we don't want to create an enemy where there at the moment is no such enemy that we should be so concerned about, that we build our capabilities to counter this Chinese threat. It may be there in the future, but not as yet. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Admiral Koda.
Yep. I'd like to make some comment.
Destroyer driver, so my English, also, I do not have any doctor's degree, so just lazy, sloppy ex-destroyer driver. Sometimes I need to use some, the slides. The first, but Cole, I think his presentation is very well organized and very precise. And one thing which really attracted my intent was the U.S. threshold, especially in South China Sea. And that is really a concern of the regional nations. Why? This is a little different view from our Korean friend, the Dr. Law. you know, if the U.S. threshold is too high, probably U.S.
would not be there if anything happens. At that time, even the capability of the Chinese Navy would be very low, like what he said, Chinese low capability Navy becomes the threat. So, you know, the threat is basically the relative view to each other. So especially each independent nation is the ASEAN. The Chinese capabilities sometimes look like very threatening. So that's something we should take into account. And one thing, I think I really do want the debate to mention this part, the real meaning of freedom of navigation. Okay, many people interpret the freedom of navigation is just the guarantee to the safe of navigation. Yes, 50%. But at the same time, freedom of navigation is the U.S. tool to intervene the ASEAN or Southeast Asia, where U.S. has no treaty obligation. If anything, any conflict happens between the regional nations in Asia, especially among the non-treaty nations with the United States, okay, U.S. may be able to say, oh, no, your conflict may threat U.S. national interest. So in order for the United States or Washington, D.C. to protect national interest in South China Sea, we would be there. This is very strong signal to Beijing that don't go to the adventurism. And I think somebody, Michita-san mentioned something about the NATO nation. Yes, in the Cold War days, we coordinated very well. The NATO really trapped the Russians' right hand and the right leg. In the ASEAN, US-Japan treaty really trapped Russia's left hand, or Soviet left hand and left legs. That's how it worked. Very good coordination. But today, okay, US and Japan is doing a lot of effort to guarantee the freedom of navigation. Especially what happens, US would come, and Japan is in support of the US, we will do that. But in this case, today, the NATO nations, European nation, NATO nations, is a little indifferent to what is happening in Asia. So that's something I really want you to take into account. And also, I want the BAT mention something about this part. And the Dr. Michishita, yes, made a very good comparison, or sometimes striking, you know, the comparison between the Cold War days and the today. And that's true. During my 40 years career, I spent 20 years in Cold War days. And last part of Cold War days, I was commander and strategic thinker, like the Paul Giella in Washington, D.C. We worked together, okay? But at that same time, I was the commanding officer of the destroyer. And what I thought in that days, okay, the U.S. maritime strategy was a kind of Bible for the defense planning and the development of the operational concept. And today, what do we have? The sea battle, still very ambiguous. So, Dr. Michishita's, you know, the presentation, I think aiming the very good point. But probably this is something related to the second session, but what should we do for the next? That will be the key point. And also the Bat Cole and Michishita-san's presentation, you know, especially the role of US and Japan. How does Beijing see the role of US and Japan, especially Japanese effort to maintain the US presence in the region, not only the Western Pacific, but also the South China Sea toward the Indian Ocean? How does Beijing interpret? And how does Beijing react? This is the A2AD strategy. So, well, this is something you're very familiar with, right? Yokosuka, we're doing. Sasebo, yep. And this is A280 strategy, okay? This is my interpretation, or my understanding. This is how Beijing interpret. And this is the Beijing reaction. So this is our threat. Okay, Beijing, the carrier, no problem. But what Beijing is going to deploy is first the anti-ship ballistic missile in 10 to 15 years from now, and intercept the incoming US forces. Right here, okay? And then China would deploy SSN. This is another threat. And at the same time, Beijing may employ what my terminology, but domain control or denial. They may employ EMP, which you are familiar with, or anti-satellite, or seabed fiber networks. China may destroy all of these assets, which really are the core part of the US nerve. Washington or Hawaii may survive. That means brain would survive. And muscle, US forces there would survive. But if the nerve is killed, meaningless. So these are the real military threat we have to take into account. And this is something I want you to discuss. Yeah, this is Paul Geller. Okay? This is your picture, right? Yeah. This may happen in 10 years from now. Okay? Or submarine force. Okay, literally discussed today. In Cold War days, we did. But today, everybody forgot about the submarine. But for the Chinese, you know, A280 strategy point of view, especially maritime strategy point of view, okay, these would be the very important asset to stop, actually to deter the US presence, together with the domain denial effort. So this is something I think I really want you to discuss in this table. And also, the second set, this is your concern. First island chain. Okay, how does Beijing interpret? Okay, there are so many US bases. And China may launch the first attack against US basing in mainland Japan and Okinawa using their ballistic missile, cruise missile, and sometimes sabotage. Okay? And they may seize our western land. Why? They need to control the choke point. Today, who has control? Japan, the 7th Fleet. I, as a former fleet commander, I have a strong confidence. Next 20 years, we'll do that. But far beyond that, I don't know. Okay? But at least we have to understand and interpret there would be future threat. So how to react to Beijing's second half of the A280? Okay, first half, real maritime. Second half, the amphibious or land island operations. So there are two different, totally different nature of threat we have to take into account. And the third, okay, this is my concluding point. Dr. Luz, the point, basically his view, I agree with him. Okay, but why Korea doesn't feel any threat? Okay, please think about that. If there were war, no US-Japan alliance, and US is out of the area, are you happy? Even like he said, small, capable Chinese Navy may become the largest threat to them, and China would be able to control all the areas. This is how we, my opinion, we should interpret the Chinese. So this is the real meaning. Okay? So this is real, the demarcation between the US-Japan effort and Chinese adventuring. This is the real nature of the first island chain. Okay.
Patrick, thank you for having me today into the Center for New American Security for this fascinating series and for gathering such a great group of really intelligent people. It's always wonderful to be in the presence of Koda Sensei, from whom I learn something every time. But I want to start with my remarks by speaking to the stars of our panel, the first three speakers. Dr. Cole talked a little bit about something that came up yesterday at a speech I was at, where Admiral Gortney described this aspiration for 8-month aircraft carrier deployments. It will be aspirational, because that would be mean that they would be coming down from, I think, around an average of 9 now. I think it also probably depends on us maintaining a certain number of aircraft carriers that is, in my view, greatly under pressure, which contributes then to either longer deployments or less presence. And I think you know which one of those two wins out. It's longer deployments. This question of the PLAN carrier, its capabilities notwithstanding, that ship isn't meant to fight us. That ship is meant to cow neighbors. It is meant to show China's capability to project power in its near abroad. I don't expect it to show up off San Diego anytime soon, or Hawaii, or Guam. Dr. Michishita, I had a fascinating presentation reminding us all of the maritime strategy of the 1980s. And we have a tendency in modern life to try and draw parallels. You have the very, very popular parallel right now of the pre-World War I period to now. You have discussion, this was the discussion of the Soviet Union in the 70s and 80s. Versus today. There is a quantifiable and qualified difference in the capability the Soviet Union put on the playing field at that time and the capability that the PLA and the PLAN put on the playing field now. There's no question about it. And this gets to some of Dr. Lowe's comments. Ultimately, though, my concern isn't today, because I think most observers would agree, such a war, if it happened in the near term, might not be all of that successful for the PRC. It's the trajectories that bother me. It is the United States' crushing financial problems, seeming inability to get its domestic political affairs in order to in a manner that would adequately fund its continuing obligations, responsibilities, and interests. Those have not in any way declined. We have global interests, and we are the one nation on earth that seeks to be able to protect them with military power wherever they may be. That's increasingly under pressure as China seeks to increase its capability to protect its interests. I am not suggesting China seeks to displace the United States as this global guarantor of freedom of the seas. I think they have no interest in that. I think they have a very, very clear interest in ejecting the United States as a Pacific power. And I believe, as a naval strategist, that they don't have to build a navy that's as big as ours to do that. They have to build a navy that's big and powerful enough to contest the navy that we can send thousands of miles away. This is a trick. This is a trick only the United States does very well these days, and that is to project considerable combat power thousands of miles from its own shore to be able to resupply it, to be able to protect those supply lines, to be able to bring that power to bear. I think that, in this 20 to 30 year trajectory that Dr. Lowe suggested, is up for grabs. The problem with Dr. Lowe's very sanguine view of the world is that it takes a long time to build navies. It takes a long time, or dare I say, to rebuild navies. This doesn't happen overnight. This gets at why the why the founders told us to raise armies and sustain a navy, right? It takes time. And so in my view, we have to be very, very clear about what our interests are and how we will protect them. Which brings me to sort of the final point I wish to make. The key, this is like that 1983 movie War Games that some of you may have seen, right? At the end of the movie, the computer says, the only way to win is not to play. The only way for the United States, in my view, to win this war, if it ever comes, is to not fight it, is to keep it 5 years away, ad infinitum. That means to be forward and powerful in a way that causes decision makers in China to wake up every morning and say, today is not the day. I believe that we can be smarter about how we inject ourselves in peacetime into the region with our network of friends and allies in a way that presents the PRC with a continuing series of logistics and strategic challenges rather than what it seems exists today is a math problem, which is, I know where all their forces are, I know how many missiles it would take to defeat them, I need to build that many missiles. Thank you very much.
All right, well, I think it's a great set of comments to kick off a discussion. Lots of issues on the table, Chinese strategy, balancing the type of deterrence Brian's talking about with the threshold tests that Dr. Cole raised, the role of Europe, the actual intensity or not of the threat that we're talking about, the role of choke points, timelines, and trajectories. So rather than ask a question myself, I'm going to open it up to the audience. Please raise your hand, identify yourself, wait for the mic, and keep your comments relatively short. While we wait for folks to gather thoughts, I guess I'll put a question on the table that maybe we can get to either now or at some point, which is to take Dr. Lo's charge seriously and ask the question about, if we believe that the salami slicing strategy is true, and if we see trends of increasing control in the first island chain, let's go to the next step of the implications of that, rather than just thinking about who owns the risk board, but rather what are the implications of that, both in peacetime and in wartime. I think often these conversations tend to talk about control, but don't talk about implications. And part of what Dr. Lo was remarking on is that even increased Chinese capabilities may not change due to incentives. So those who might disagree with that view, it would be useful to walk through in more specific terms about the implications of greater Chinese control in the South China Sea, for instance. But why don't we hold that for now? Lots of folks I know who have ideas. Who wants to go first here? Yeah, Richard Bush, Brookings.
Thank you.
And let me grab the mic. Thank you.
Richard Bush, the Brookings Institution. Thanks to all the panelists for really stimulating presentations. I worry a lot about the interaction that occurs in every country between civilian leaders and senior military officers. We've been talking about China and the United States and Japan in a sense as sort of single actors, but they're not. And civilian leaders don't necessarily understand military strategy. Military leaders don't necessarily understand larger national objectives. So I guess my question is, put it simplistically, how do the leaders of Japan, China, and the United States, how smart are they when they come to military strategy and the way the military element of national power is being used? To what extent do navies necessarily understand the international purpose? I guess I pose it to Dr. Lo, whose presentation I liked and who doesn't have, or has the least dog in this fight. So,
good morning, Richard. Good to see you. I don't know how to answer that. I live in a world where I've been advising our defense ministry, Korean National Defense Ministry, for the last two decades, I guess. And I talked to a lot of generals, many of whom were former students when I was in the military teaching at our academy. And we had to spend some time really thinking about who these generals are. Beyond their bars and gold stripes and stars, you know, they're supposedly intelligent human beings concerned with national security as I am. And it's how you define national security. And what sort of threat you see out there, and how you design your defense to address those threats to the national security at a diplomatic level, at a political level, at a military level. So far as I can tell, the Chinese do the same thing in their own way. And I think the defense intellectuals are listened to very carefully by the party leaders in Beijing, just like discussions here. Our political leaders listen to us as well as our military leaders. Hopefully over a period of discussion and evaluation, you come up with a rational, sensible defense strategy for the present and for the future. I could easily join with someone like my Japanese colleague here, Admiral Koda, and count the beans and say, yes, the Chinese are the same imminent threat. Mind you, the Chinese talk about America's decline. And with my close Chinese friends in Beijing, I'll sit down and joke with them. I'm old enough to remember 1975, are you? And quite a few of them are not. And I was an adult back then. And I remember an America that was very dispirited at the end of the Vietnam War. 2 years into the first oil crisis, American economy in shambles, inflation raging. And a very, very dispirited America. And compare 75 to today. With all of the malaise that my American friends feel today, I don't think it's half as bad as 75 felt. This is the one country on this planet that I know of in my short lifespan thus far that has the capability, unlike my own or even like China, to rejuvenate itself in a very fundamental way. I still believe that the U.S. has this capability. It's a strength very few countries have on this planet. And this is why I disagreed when I was teaching here with a gentleman like Mr. Kennedy, who talked about decline of empires. The British decline was an absolute one. If we talk about America's decline, it could possibly be a relative. I don't want to get into too much detail here, Richard, but suffice to say that I don't see the Chinese being the kind of threat that some people portray China to be already. I tend to believe that what I've seen in China since 1979, my first visit to China was in 88, as you know, and even in the last two decades, or less than two decades, the Chinese character, the character of the country itself, has transformed so fundamentally that somebody who visited in 1988, visiting China today, would not recognize this country. It's not the same animal, and it will continue to change. The Chinese population is vastly young. They're not like their parents' generation. The younger Chinese, of course, are prone to manipulations by the state of nationalistic symbols, certainly. But they're very intelligent young people, all very, very connected to the world. The internet, the connectivity in China is no less good than in D.C. Young kids in China see what's happening in the world. They know what the U.S. is all about. They have no desire for military conflict. Take everything into context. Yeah, the militaries need their places. Navies have their ships, beautiful white uniforms compared to us, infantry grunts being in our dull gray uniforms. Our boats look beautiful. Korea happens to be the number one shipbuilding nation in the world still. But if we talk about the Chinese naval threat, we're building submarines, not pretty looking ships on the surface. I'll stop there.
Okay. Why don't we go in reverse order, some Japanese and American perspectives on this question of civil military relations.
Okay. I think we can again learn from the Cold War period. It took us like 25 years to be able to, you know, kind of prevent major crises. You know, there were major crises in the 1950s and 60s and 70s, as I said. But, you know, when was it that the United States and the Soviet Union signed the Maritime Safety Agreement, 1971 or 2? So it took, and there was no major crisis in which those two superpowers came close to the brink of war after 1975, as I recall. So, I mean, if it takes like 25 years again, we are talking about, 2035, year 2035. Around that time, China will have caught up with the United States in terms of its economic power. So, I mean, this is an important period. If we just take a lesson and apply it to the present time, if we can manage the situation for next 25 years, we might be able to, you know, get over this and come up with some kind of a more stable international relationship. There is one challenge. Second point is that the world has been more democratized and globalized. During the Cold War, Soviet Union was a totalitarian government. There was bipartisan consensus within the United States. You know, political leaders, military leaders didn't have to worry too much about politics, right? You know, but now, things have been very much democratized in Japan as well as in China. China still is controlled by the Communist Party, but I mean, if you take a look at the situation, China is Chinese leadership is pretty exposed, pretty much exposed to its domestic pressure. And Baidu, Twitter, internet chatting system works to shape views in that country. And so Chinese leaders have to pay attention to the public opinion. So we have to, not only to educate and kind of train political as well as military leaders in those countries to do a better job or to become better in taking care of these crises and political military matters, but also we have to start educating really people of these countries and the media. Media's role would be very important in this round of strategic competition among major powers. Thanks.
Frank, I personally was very happy in 1975 for various reasons. And as far as the civil-military relations in the United States are concerned, I think former Secretary of Defense Gates has some pretty strong opinions. But with respect to China, I think that my interpretation is when President Xi wakes up in the morning, the first thing he thinks about are domestic issues. You know, all politics is local. But having said that, because of the booming Chinese economy or the growing Chinese economy, he is also able, I think, the Chinese, what we call the National Command Authority, is also able to devote significant effort and resources to defending Chinese sovereign interests, which currently we see most evidence in the East and South China Seas. So I think that while since the succession of leadership in China following Deng Xiaoping, where we have, I think we're seeing emerging a more sort of, from a Western perception, a more traditional set of civil-military relationships. Just because the domestic issues predominate in Beijing does not mean that they're not able also to pay significant attention to these sovereign maritime interests. Thank you.
Any questions from the audience?
On your sort of perspective on the sort of huge, but certainly less, if you will, alarmist or frightened than other places in Asia. But I just wondered if you comment on that. Thanks.
Thank you. I think, you know, we could spend a whole day talking about this in a different context rather than this kind of panel. Of course we worry about the prospects of a China that grows preponderant in our region. But we this worry for somebody of my ilk is leavened somewhat by the hope and expectation to a certain degree that the character of Chinese leadership will continue to change in a positive direction as it has done since the 80s. I think, on the whole, thoughtful Koreans would like to see a future where America's, let's say, more neutrally, the security architecture in the region remains what it is, with China evolving in a way that it can participate in this architecture in a positive way. With respect to the maritime domain, it would mean China cooperating with the naval forces in the region, the US, Japan, Korea, Australia, in keeping the sea lanes of communication open, safe as it is today, because we all rely on maritime trade, vitally rely. South Korea's trade, 85% goes through the ocean to our trading partners around the world. China, pretty much the same. Same with Japan, I would think. So stability in the seas, in the Pacific, is important to all of us. I think as Chinese leadership matures, Xi Jinping is only in his first year. He's got, as Dr. Colby correctly pointed out, I think, great problems domestically. He's got far more problems domestically than he has in foreign policy arena. I don't think he needs to create any bigger problems than he has with either Japan, Korea, or the U.S. Things are pretty stable, and I think he likes it that way. He should keep it that way. So we would hope for a China that understands that stability benefits not just us, but China as well. I'll stop there.
Admiral McDevitt, next. Excuse me. Hi, Mike McDevitt from CNA. First, I'd like to highlight how much I agree with the two or three view graphs that Yoji Koda put up on the screen to kind of capture very, very succinctly the nature of the security problem. And so I think that's the longer term issue that we need to deal with. But my comment or question for Professor Mishita is, I too have written about the similarity between the Soviet approach to dealing with an approaching maritime threat and the Chinese approach. But I think it would be a terrible mistake to try to draw too many lessons from the Cold War. The geography is a bit different. The circumstances are very different. And so I was surprised by your observation that China is trying to turn the South China Sea into a SSBN bastion. To my knowledge, there is no evidence to support that assertion. The reason I believe that that China is putting their SSBNs in Hainan is if you look at all of their ports, it's the only one that you can get underway and get into deep water very quickly. All the rest of them, the East China Sea is very, Yellow Sea, very, very shallow. And so the logic of being able to get into deep water indicates that at least China is considering the fact that, like the United States, if they do finally send their SSBNs or develop a significant SSBN force, they're going to use the vast ocean to hide them in as opposed to do what the Soviets did. There's no evidence that China has any desire to create a bastion. The reason the Soviets did so is because their submarines were vulnerable when they were operating in the high seas. I think you're connecting too many dots from the maritime strategy of the 1980s to today, and getting wrapped up in trying to create exact parallels, I think, misleads away from what the real operational and strategic problem is.
Can I respond? Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, I agree with you in that certainly the geostrategic position of the Sea of Ohotsk and the South China Sea is vastly different, and I take your point. And maybe I was sounded too much into a drawing similarities between, I mean, I didn't know, remember whether I said China is trying to turn this into a SSBN bastion. But, you know, what I was trying to say is that they are, you know, make a point that there are kind of similarities. And, you know, Soviet strategies during the Cold War changed over time. I mean, Soviet naval strategies in the 1970s mainly focused on the disruption of Western sea lines of communications, whereas it turned its focus to a SSBN bastion strategy toward the end of the 1970s. So it changes. So I know, understand that fact that it changed and Chinese strategies will change over time, and that there will be. So I think, I mean, if you take a look at what China has been doing, it's really testing different options. And it's, you know, sent a fleet through a Tsugaru Strait, you know, sent fleets to penetrate the different points, choke points in the southeast western island chains, Ryukyu island chain. So, I mean, so one of these, I mean, I was suggesting maybe, you know, China might think a Soviet model, kind of SS, turning South China Sea into a, not maybe necessarily into a bastion, but an important operating place for its SSBNs, for which it takes a lot of protection. Thanks. And I would like you to read your paper, so please send it.
Dr. Lowe, we haven't met, but I must say that I really enjoyed your remarks, not least because they were the most unexpected. Pretty much nobody else surprised me, but you really did. When Michi Shita-san and Admiral Koda showed their charts, I don't know if you can see them, but there were some comparisons that Admiral McDivitt just alluded to between the Cold War and the future security environment. And it seems to me that that comparison was instructive, because something like that is going to be going on. The reason we're talking about the security of the first island chain is that the first island chain is the road in and it's the road out, and it's the inevitable maritime geography. And I take the point that the Chinese have a lot of problems at home and they would prefer not to have to fight, but of course that's the Chinese approach, to win without fighting. So going forward, it seems that we are going to see something like what Admiral Koda showed us, with red arrows coming out and blue arrows going in, if you can describe it that way. What role do you anticipate the Republic of Korea is going to take in that, if any? Is the Republic of Korea going to stay on the peninsula and attend to the DMZ and everything north of there? Or with the naval capabilities that the ROK is building, are you going to come to sea and be part of that maritime coalition?
Thank you. We're talking theoreticals, aren't we? When that kind of map becomes reality, we may not even have a DMZ. That's a possibility too, you know. Now, if I were sitting in a room where we were wargaming, if I were sitting in a room with different types of people, and we're talking about potential war scenarios, I would obviously be talking very differently than I am now. I don't think we're here to talk about war scenarios. Having said that, Mr. Jara, Let me assure you that unless the character of my country changes entirely, the Republic of Korea is a treaty ally to the United States of America. We have been since October of 1953. Korea fought on the side of the US in a very unpopular Vietnam War. We had, at any given time, roughly 55,000 serving ground troops fighting next to American soldiers in Vietnam for 7 years. We are the last country to withdraw from Vietnam. I don't think the US should have any doubt where the Republic of Korea will be should events come to the kind of blue and green arrows that we saw on the chart.
Michishita has a response as well. Just before you do that, I'd be interested in of course, his and others' response on the panel to think about some of the other regional actors here, the degree to which countries like Philippines, Australia, Vietnam, India, Singapore, and others are playing into these equation, or is this primarily a game of the major powers in which the other countries will not have a significant role?
Well, I think, I mean, in terms of South Korea's future role, strategic role, I think it's good news is that South Korean Navy is developing, making progress as a blue water Navy as the Japanese, kind of following the path of the Japanese Navy, which is a good, some Japanese naval officers don't like it. You know, they say, well, Koreans are imitating us all the time. When we buy this and they will buy that, you know, when we buy that, they will buy that too. But I think I kind of disagree with them. Psychologically, you might not like it, but from the national interest point of view, it's a good news, because if South Korea comes up with more or less the same naval capabilities with ours, that means we will be able to, plug South Korean Navy into our U.S.-Japan alliance and make it a integral partner if it chooses to. The question is, will it choose to do it? And that's, I think, there is a big question mark, and I don't think in the foreseeable future, South Korea will not take sides between the US, Japan on the one hand and China on the other hand. But I mean, if you take a look at, China, we see a lot of good news about China-South Korea relationship, but there are difficulties too, We always talk about Senkaku Islands and the issue with between Japan and China, and it's a big issue. But nobody has been killed over these islands. But between South Korea and China already, two South Korean Coast Guard members have been killed, and one Chinese fisherman was killed by South Korean Coast Guard. They decided not to make a fuss out of this for political reasons, but there are kind of the difficulties there. It would be a good news if South Korea, in a way, it's a good news if South Korea does not have to choose to side with us, because that means that China will remain more or less peaceful. But if China becomes not very peaceful and friendly with South Korea, as long as South Korea constructs a kind of military capabilities and operational capacity to work with us, they have an option to choose.
Okay, I think we have time for one more question, and then we'll give the panelists a chance to wrap up. Yeah.
Hello, I'm John Hanley. I just represent myself. But we've spoken mostly about Navy today in the context of defending the first half of the chain. Appreciate any comments about the role of land-based forces and the future threat they present and also the nation. Thank you.
Brian, why don't you start?
Thank you for that question. This is, I work naval strategy all the time, but I occasionally dabble in other things. Spent a good part of the last 2 years thinking a lot about Army air and missile defense, the Army's role in the Pacific, these sorts of things. It's big in the news right now. Quite frankly, I think the Army is grasping at straws a little bit and attempting to apply something it's very comfortable with, the brigade combat team construct, in a way that doesn't seem to really fit the needs of the theater, when it has at its disposal its air and missile defense force, specifically in its Patriot and THAAD, a capability that is both useful to the peacetime environment and in the deterrence of war and in the assurance of allies, and could theoretically be used as a way of injecting doubt into the minds of PRC decision makers through its flexibility. Both the U.S. Marine Corps and the U.S. Air Force wish to disperse forces to operate from austere bases. Those bases are likely to have to be protected. The U.S. Army's air defense posture in the Pacific has become static, immobile, unimaginative. It needs to change. It is, however, probably, in my view, the best contribution the Army has to this peacetime deterrent and putting conflict off. If it became a tool of mobility and engagement such throughout the first island chain in a way that every couple of months a new exercise happens where there's a Patriot battalion employed, or even something less than a battalion, moving THAAD around every now and then in order to create places where it can operate, where it can be put later if necessary, pre-surveyed, pre-studied, those sorts of things. I think the Army's missing a huge capability by not thinking more about how its air and missile defense can play in this theater.
Great, thank you. I think in the interest of time, I know Dr. Machichita wants to respond to that as well. Why don't we go down in the order that the speaker spoke? You can address this question of the role of the Army and any other concluding thoughts. We just want to take a few minutes and put some more issues on the table.
Okay, thank you very much. With respect to John's question, I think it was Nelson who said a ship is a fool to fight a fort. But having said that, I don't think there's been any major sea battle in the history of the world that has occurred more than about 200 nautical miles from the beach. So land power or land-based power has always played a role, and I think will continue to. I think in the case of China, however, we're seeing a deliberate approach to use its continentally based forces to help, if not totally, exert eventual sea control over the areas it deems vital to its national security, something we shouldn't be surprised at. Finally, I'll mention the merging of land and sea power. In my personal experience, is perhaps best example is the South Korean command and control system, the South Korean U.S. command and control system, both ashore and at sea, which is really very impressive. In more general terms, I'd like to thank Admiral Koda, who I continue to learn from after all these years, particularly with his suggestion about freedom of navigation, which indeed is a baseline for U.S. maritime concerns certainly in the South China Sea. For Dr. Lo, I appreciate his comments, and I agree that vis-a-vis the U.S., the Chinese naval threat or power is potential. But I would caveat that by noticing that I don't think China is at all trying to emulate the Soviet Union, trying to match the U.S. ship for ship or missile for missile. Rather, I think Chinese military modernization is aimed at very specific objectives, be it Taiwan or various sovereignty issues in the East or South China Seas. Frankly, if I were a young naval planner in Beijing today, I'd be very concerned about future budget allocations. In other words, if the Taiwan situation is resolved peacefully, which I personally think it will be, how do I continue justifying these large budget increases to continue modernizing the Navy? Finally, as far as I have great respect for my Korean colleagues. I spent many years operating with the South Korean Navy. But as a British Prime Minister once said, a nation only has permanent interests that does not have permanent allies. And frankly, I can foresee a future 10, 20, 30 years from now when it would be in the South Korean national interest or the Korean national interest not to take up arms against China, no matter who our allies nominally were. Thank you.
Thank you. I have just one comment on the land-based, land ground forces. I think Japan, it's interesting to see how Japan has decided to acquire amphibious landing capabilities in this new National Defense Program guidelines, which has two implications. One is certainly we are focused on the defense of the Senkaku Islands, but another implication is its potential use for island defense, first island chain defense. Because during the Cold War, we couldn't do a conduct amphibious landing operations because basically it was about, the US Marine Corps were supposed to take part of a Sakhalin island or the southern Kuril Islands in case of news. But those islands are occupied by the Soviet Union, and because we, Japan, maintained an exclusively defensively oriented defense policy, we do even now, we couldn't have amphibious or mount amphibious operations to take those islands. But now, we are trying to defend our, this first island chain belongs to us. We can use our own forces to take those islands in case of need. I think so. We have to wait and see what happens. But our amphibious landing capability will have two major implications, which touches on the defense of the first island chain.
Thank you, Dr. Cole. I think it was Palmerston. You're paraphrasing.
It was.
It was 19th century British foreign policy, and his remarks were directed against British policy on the continent. The situation today in Northeast Asia is a little bit different than Palmerston's England. And at least since 1945, if I remember correctly, Britain has had a very different foreign policy, aligning itself with the US and not looking at Europe principally. So anyway, historical parallels be whatever they may be. I think if a future comes where Korea has to make a decision about its future security, divided or united, in a world where the United States is no longer the principal rule setter globally and certainly in North Asia, South Korea may take decisions that might quite surprise you as well as the Chinese in terms of the ultimate guarantor to our security in a world where China starts becoming very aggressive and unpeaceful. I'll stop there with respect to what a Korea might do. As far as we live in a world where America still sets the fundamental rules that we abide by in the region, and where those rules that it set post-1945 have benefited the region immensely, not just the US, I think our security policy will be in line with that of the United States. I don't think our alliance relationship with the US will change very fundamentally in the foreseeable future. Certainly, I don't think in my lifetime. I find it a little off-putting to hear a Japanese colleague say, Japanese-US Nichibei relationship and the Koreans. I thought we were part of the same alliance framework, number one, that during the Cold War, Korea was at the forefront of the Cold War against the Soviet Union and the Chinese, and the Japanese-US alliance, the Nichibei alliances, key as it is, was a regard to the front that we represented. Now, having said that, I'll stop there on that point also. Let us just hope that intelligent thinking prevails in this region amongst the Chinese, amongst the Japanese, amongst Americans and Koreans. We do need greater transparency. We do need some of the mechanisms that we had towards the end of the Cold War that created greater confidence amongst European nations as well as in between the Soviet Union and the US. We used to call them confidence building measures. Perhaps we could build an architecture from present day onwards that creates greater CBMs between China, the US, and the other countries in the region. They could be naval CBMs, they could be all kinds of CBMs that we could work on instead of, you know, raising threat profiles. Perhaps it would work at a diplomatic level to create greater avenues of contact, dialogue, discussion, and grievance settling, even, so that problems don't become military problems. I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you. Admiral Cota?
Yeah, the two or three comments on China. The first, I'm a frequent visitor to Beijing, 7 times in this last year, and mainly working on how to establish the CBM between two nations. And one thing I always got surprised is the fact they use their terminology differently to US, Japan, or perhaps South Korea. Whenever we talk bilaterally, Chinese military rep always said, we are not afraid of going for all-out war against Japan. Okay. They never said that to the US. I said, okay, whenever, come, I'll beat you. This is my response. But, you know, okay, so one thing I want you Americans to really pay attention is whatever they say is not necessarily whatever they say to Japan or ASEAN nations. Okay. This is the point. If you fail to understand this point, the Washington DC may be trapped. Okay. This is one point. And the second, in any military or security issue, we should have take two factors into account. One is the capability and one is intent. I'm not opposing to Dr. Lau, but you know, especially for the military, strategic planner and force planner, we pay much attention on the capability. So, and also the long term. So if we fail to misinterpret Chinese future military force build-up, we too, US, Japan, to be trapped in the future. And the third, the Chinese carrier, I agree totally with Dr. Lau, okay? The more the China built their carriers, the better security environment for ours. They are wasting their money. Is there any Brits here? Just no. Any? Brits are wasting the money to build two carriers, okay? China is making much worse mistake. If they were to build more submarines, their A280 really works. But carrier powers has no contribution to their A280 capability, okay? Of course, showing the flag to ASEAN nations or some island nations in Indian Ocean or perhaps Pacific or Africa, they may work if US are not there. But Japan in a position to support the US presence. That means Japan is the enabler of the US new policy and strategy rebalancing and the access assurance. Japan will do that. Okay. And there's some sensitivity Japan-ROC relationship. The military-to-military exchange between ROC military and Japan self-defense force is not old. Started late 1990s. Okay. The JMCDF was the first runner, front runner. And I, as a captain in charge of the Navy policy, I visited Tejon and I requested the strategic talks. That was the very beginning, okay, 1996. Okay. And so I was a strong supporter, but are there any deep, in-depth strategic exchange of opinions, we do not still understand why ROC Navy built so many submarines. We don't understand. Okay?
They're not aircraft.
But my point is, the degree of exchange is far infant than what it should be. This is my point, okay? So, and also, another point is, the US-ROC alliance is a kind of tailored alliance to prepare for the North. And Japan-US alliance is, you know, of course, the one defense of Japan, but also Japan is providing the vast amount of the bases 6 active air bases, 2 naval bases, 1/3 of Marines in Japan. But you know, this is how Japan is making a contribution. This enables U.S. more flexible military actions in the area, and enables the U.S. to stay here in this region. So I believe this should be the future Japanese course of action. But that, at the same time, one point, the fundamental nature of the U.S.-Japan alliance and U.S. alliance is very different. So how to bridge those two different alliances among militaries or political leadership, that is the key for the future success. And the third, role of ground forces, simple too. After the end of Korean War, the U.S. has not maintained any ground forces in Asia, except 3MEF in Okinawa. 3MEF is not the pure ground forces, right? But there was, of course, the good reason for the United States not to keep maritime theater and the no NATO type the alliances. But at the same time, U.S. was ready to come, is ready to come, and I think will be so. In terms of if anything happens in Taiwan, U.S. should send ground forces to this area via Japan. If anything happens in Taiwan, U.S. would send ground forces to this area, not necessarily Taiwan, but via Japan. Okay. Japan would be the key node for the U.S. ground forces operations. And so my point is, permanently stationing the U.S. Army in this area is not so important. But preparing for the U.S. ground forces presence in this region, it has much more significance toward Beijing. And last thing, yes, exactly what he said. The recent concern is of the anti-missile defense, ballistic and cruise missile defense against not North Korea, but China. Of course, Washington's policy does not single out China as a threat, but Chinese capability is there. If they are targeting Japanese more than 200 targets at this moment, by ballistic missile and cruise missile. How should we develop our capability? Okay. Japan alone, we have the only, other than Israel, we have the only allied nation which has the BMD capability, but against North. How do we take Chinese future capability into our planning is another key for our successful alliance. Yeah, this is my point. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Lowe has asked for 10 seconds, and then Brian is going to wrap up.
10 seconds. I think my American friends in Seoul might be upset that I didn't say this. The 3rd Marines are, of course, in Okinawa, but the U.S. has a 2nd Infantry ID in Korea. It's a very augmented, very powerful fighting unit, ground forces, infantry division in Korea. And as many of you will know, there's a 25th ID infantry division in Hawaii as reserve. Thank you.
Just very quickly, Eli, there's a battle raging in my brain that might be raging in yours, and that is China different? Is it different because of its Confucianism and its Maoism and its communism and its strategic culture? I think Tom Mankin's in the room, and he's written brilliantly about Chinese strategic culture. Is it different? Or is it a Mark I, Mod Zero, International Relations 101, rising power? I don't know. I think China Inc. would like us to believe that it is the former. As a strategist, I prefer to believe the latter. Thank you.
All right, great. Well, please join me in thanking the panel, and we'll reconvene in about 10 minutes.